Go to qualified buyers for your product or service that is fast and easy. No more wasting time getting leads manually. No more pre-configured lists of names that don't fit your business. Hoover's advanced targeting technology helps you reach the market that will be most receptive to your product or service. For a limited time, Hoover's would like to offer their radio listeners 50 free leads and a 24-hour trial.
Just call 800-606-LEAD with a free trial and 50 free leads. Call now, 800-606-LEAD, 800-606-LEAD, again, 800-606-LEAD.
Fall means football, and football means tailgating, and Harbor Q is back with us at WNST, offering some of the best Carolina-style pit barbecue anywhere near the Inner Harbor. It's Harbor Q, tailgating packages, catering, and hickory smoked meats by the pound. Dine on the swine at Harbor Q, 1421 Lawrence Street. Harbor Q feeds the WNST family every Wednesday. Let them feed yours.
Call 410-685-PORK or visit harborq.com. Catering available.
Are you a business owner looking for a competent and loyal HVAC contractor? Then you should call Don Mellinger and the good people at Site Support Services at 410-779-0911. Service is on a veteran-owned small business serving the Mid-Atlantic region for over 25 years. Site Support Services can manage all of our mission-critical HVAC, electrical, maintenance, and installation needs. A premier Liebert USA contractor, Site Support Services is available for 24/7 emergency service and AC rentals too. Don't forget, we are an electrical contractor as well, specializing in data center support and installation on generators, uninterruptible power supplies, and battery backup systems. So for all of our HVAC needs, call Site Support Services at 410-771-0911 or visit us on the web at sitesupportservices.com. You want it right. Call Site.
This is Don Mellinger, founder of Site Support Services. If you want it done right, call Site.
We return to our non-town sports beat with Daryl Nelson.
This is the Mobtown Sports Beat. Here's Daryl Nelson.
Here we go.
Welcome back. Mobtown Sports Beat, 410-481-1570, the number. WNST.net, the website. Hour number one of the program, just heard from Jordan Campbell, New Mexico Highlands, formerly of USC as well, and soon to be in an NFL city near you. Coming up, top of the 1 o'clock hour, Les Carpenter, Yahoo Sports scheduled to join us. He, like many, weighed in on the Joe Flacco contract over the weekend, and we're all sort of anxiously awaiting the details as they trickle out once the thing gets filed officially with league offices. Again, remember that all the talk this weekend was over a verbal agreement, essentially. Expectation is that Flacco will or maybe did sign it today. 6 years, 120.6, and it seems that, again, first and foremost, we acknowledge the Ravens didn't have a hurry of choice. All other choices from a Ravens perspective seem to be bad choices. It was hang the exclusive tag on Joe Flacco and pay him 20-plus million this year, or maybe 19 based on some of the restructures that have happened in the last couple of weeks leading up to this deal being agreed to. Either way, every bit of that 19 and or that 19 or $20 million would have been not only guaranteed but accounted for under this year's salary cap as well. They could have applied the non-exclusive franchise tag and played an expensive game of chicken with Joe Flacco, allowing him to go out on the open market and potentially sign an offer sheet with teams who apparently would have been willing to offer up a pair of first-round draft choices in order to attain the quarterback services. And in so doing, the Ravens would have also, you know, allowed the biggest and most important and most lucrative contract in team history to be negotiated by someone else, to be potentially negotiated by a rival, which couldn't have been necessarily in their best interest either. And so The other option, of course, would have been to simply let him go out onto the free market and test his opportunities and bring back those offers to the Ravens if they felt that there was some level of reciprocation in order, at least. And again, that was something that was never going to happen. And so in making the best of a bad situation, the Ravens not only sort of leave all parties happy, all parties satisfied, as Joe Flacco gets to wear the title now of, highest paid player in the history of the NFL for as long as that's able to last. His agent gets to go out and use that as a selling point in attracting future clients as well. The Ravens get him back at what seems to be an agreeable cap number or an easy to work with cap number for the foreseeable future. And the expectation, of course, with this young quarterback is that these two sides will be back at the table, I would say, sometime in the ballpark of the next 2 years or so, negotiating, moving money around, and ultimately trying to make this deal remain livable, remain feasible for both sides of the arrangement. And yet, again, all of the reaction so far this weekend has seemingly been to the title of highest paid. So many fans count themselves as smarter than Ozzie Newsome, as wiser than the wisest GM in all of NFL football, perhaps. So many fans suddenly concerned about the Ravens' cap health moving forward. Non-Ravens fans, that is, overly concerned about the Ravens' cap health moving forward. And again, without details, difficult to make arguments one way or the other. But the early indications seem to be the first couple of years, go beyond being just livable from a Ravens perspective. It proves that the NFL continues to win the propaganda war. That's one thing that's for sure. It's a league that is, made no secret, or seemingly made no secret, about the greedy machine that they have been. The league that quicker than any other seems to chew up and spit out their players, and in so doing also refusing to guarantee money, not only paying less by comparison than baseball and basketball, but also giving little assurances beyond that as well in terms of how much of the money is specifically guaranteed. And again, another fraudulent word that the NFL likes to sort of hang their hats on. And so we're going to hear a lot about those fraudulent numbers, because it's interesting that while, they'll sort of nickel and dime a player down to the lowest level of compensation that they possibly can, as soon as it's done, the league and its teams and its executives like to stand up and brag about the big fake numbers that they have generated. And over the course of the last, 10 years or so, I guess going back to Brett Favre once upon a time, we have seen, double-digit $100 million contracts given out. And by all indications, no one has really gotten all that close to the $100 million that they were promised. And, a lot of times, again, even guaranteed money. The one contract that stands out as most laughable was the $78 million contract extension that was given to Donovan McNabb as a member of the Washington Redskins, with somewhere in the ballpark of $38 to $40 million being reported as guaranteed. And, of course, when all was said and done, I believe it was about $3.5 million or so that the Redskins actually wound up coming out of pocket and compensating McNabb with. So before we get too caught up, reacting to these numbers, important to keep the important numbers in mind, which are signing bonus and, from a Ravens fans perspective, most importantly right now, the cap numbers that are generated in the early years of this deal, because, in a couple of years, you would imagine that these two sides set to go back to the table and continue to make this a livable deal for both sides of the equation. But 410-481-1570, the number. Again, both sides can count themselves as winners now walking away. The league itself can count itself as a winner, because we are once again, sort of hung up, whether for better or for worse, whether positive or negative, in talking about Joe Flacco and talking about the $120 million bounty that he has allegedly gotten courtesy of this new contract. Flacco's agent walks away a big winner. He's, as he now has that feather in his cap, or that sort of, credential on his resume. And the Ravens, who we worried so much about some of the priorities that they would have to have moving forward, who we worried so much about being able to pay a number of other players around Joe Flacco based on some of the numbers that we had heard about early on, now find themselves not only of the long-term accord with Joe Flacco, but having done so at least in the early years, or at least in the first year of this contract, for a number that is, by any measure that you look at it, less than half of what either of these franchise tag numbers would have ultimately cost them, and essentially a third of what the exclusive
franchise tag would have cost him. So now it's about what's important now. An old-time, Raven moniker, one that we've grown used to hearing around here, and certainly the Ravens look at the left tackle position, having gambled as much as they have or allegedly have on Joe Flacco moving forward, having put as much stock in his basket as they seemingly have moving forward, looking at the difference between the regular season version of this Ravens offense and the postseason version. We have to look at the left tackle position as being, you know, essential to the improvement that we saw on the offensive side of the ball. And that's not, you know, to cast it as the only reason. A lot of talk is certainly being, a lot of acknowledgement certainly being paid, made to Jim Caldwell and his influence as the offensive coordinator. But moreover, again, if you're looking for the biggest change between regular season football and postseason football for these Baltimore Ravens, it has to be the addition of Bryant McKinney on the left side at that left tackle position, because it was a threefold improvement. Not only did we take Michael Orr off of the left tackle where he seemed to struggle throughout the year and replace him with a guy who was healthy and motivated and ready to play, but moreover, by putting McKinney at the left tackle and freeing up Michael Orr, you got to put him back at his more natural position of right tackle, where he seemed, again, much more equipped to deal with the things that happen on that side of the offensive line, and much more equipped to deal with it than Coleccio Simile had been, and by default as well, supplanting Coleccio Simile from that right tackle position gave the Ravens the opportunity to plug him in at the left guard, where they had been trying a host of guys and searching for answers throughout the year. And you saw his comfort level begin to grow game by game throughout this playoff process as well. So, when we look at the left tackle position, and again, I don't expect it to be one that the Ravens are going to be all that urgent about addressing, although, part of that that expectation came from the notion that having to pay Joe Flacco, having to make some difficult decisions with a number of other guys might have precluded the Ravens from getting out and making some bids on this free agent market for any of the available left tackles that might be out there. Certainly projects to be quite the interesting decision, and one that the Ravens might be ready to slow play. Again, maybe now with the cap health that they seem to have under the terms of this new contract, they are willing to go out and kick the tires on or investigate the possibility of bringing in one of these bigger named left tackles to hold down that important position. Maybe you look at Bryant McKinney as a guy who's won back some level of trust from this team, because, there are lots of varying stories that come out about how it is that the Ravens and McKinney found themselves at odds throughout the season. What clearly is not debatable is that the Ravens, from the better part of this season, didn't feel comfortable deploying him at left tackle. When push came to shove, not only did they give him at least the opportunity to do it, but he went out and seized that opportunity as well. And so, both sides have some thinking to do. The Ravens have to figure out whether the Bryant McKinney that they saw in the playoffs is a guy that they could expect to be able to count on for the better part of the next 2 years. Bryant McKinney himself has to decide, on the open market and with real bidders out there, if indeed they're ready to come, how much loyalty, if any, he owes to a Baltimore Ravens team that waited until the 11th hour and called him on the carpet and took half of his money away, that put that half that they took away in incentive clauses, and then perhaps artificially kept him down in terms of the number of snaps and left him short of the ability to collect those incentives. So I don't know that there's a great deal of a feeling of loyalty on McKinney's part, who now has the ring, who we've heard many times about some of the financial issues that he's had to deal with, that now maybe headed out to the open market to get one last big payday and sort of set himself up. And so, again, this is a team in the Ravens that found McKinney once upon a time at the 11th hour, a team that picked up Willie Anderson once upon a time at the 11th hour and deployed him at the eligible tackle spot for an extended period of time. This is a team that has sort of had that revolving door once upon a time, filled their left tackle through supplemental draft, not the compensatory, not the expansion draft, through the supplemental draft. And so, a team that's always been sort of willing to slow play that tackle market in particular. And if there's one thing that we can guess about, with the healthy market of free agent left tackles that are out there, with the influx of talented tackles that could be headed in through the NFL draft, that there will be a lot of other guys that find themselves displaced You know that there will be guys who are, you know, based on the price tag that they carry in comparison to the role that they may now have or not have on their team moving forward, could be put in a position where, you know, they would be cast out onto the open market once the team felt comfortable making those decisions. And so maybe this is another position where the Ravens are comfortable enough to let it sort of go into, you know, into the summer, maybe into training camp before finding their answer at left tackle. But one thing seems certain that, you know, while Michael Orr should provide them a nice insurance policy, a nice level of assurance for themselves about what they might be able to do in a pinch, it's certainly far from desirable based on what we have seen to this point in his history at left tackle in comparison to right tackle. Again, we talk about it as a threefold improvement from left tackle to right tackle to left guard in terms of what the Ravens were able to do by finding or allowing Bryant McKinney an opportunity to stake his claim to this job. And so if they're to go into next season, you know, with Kelechi Osemele anywhere but that left guard position, with Michael Orr anywhere but that right tackle position, then we might be thinking of this as three steps backward to start next season as well. And so with some extra money, maybe all of a sudden the Ravens do find themselves interested in some of the bigger name, bigger, higher dollar left tackles that could be available to them via free agency as well. 410-481-1570, the number. Also, you know, Paul Kruger, a guy that I think we had sailed his ship in terms of, you know, the expectation that he's just going to get so much money by way of a free agent contract that he's going to be difficult to retain and probably not in the Ravens' best interest. Of course, we talk about the fact that Kruger has been sort of sudden on the scene, and maybe we talk about that as an organizational failure of sorts. I remember that throughout his time as a member of this team, the Ravens have sort of, you know, slow played the decision or gone back and forth on the decision as to, you know, whether he was seen as a defensive end or outside linebacker, have asked him to make body changes, conditioning changes based on those expectations, and now finally finding you know, a comfortable resting place for him. They get, you know, the best production of his career in the year where he's set to walk. And so it's, you know, the big question is, how much does Paul Kruger command out there on the open market? You know, how much is he ultimately going to be worth? How much are you willing to gamble on him, having seen essentially one very good year of production and not much else prior to that? And maybe now, although, again, all of the talk was that there would be no other franchise taggable player besides Joe Flacco, maybe now with a tag at their disposal, albeit an expensive tag, that one more year to sort of try out Paul Kruger to see if he is able to back up or duplicate the efforts of last year, not beyond the realm of possibility, at least with some of the financial freedom that may have been created now by this Joe Flacco contract. And, of course, a lot of folks looking toward Danelle Ellerbe. You know, for all of the guys that we talk about as potentially gone, and it begins with Kruger, and it continues through Kerry Williams and Ed Reed, and even to some degree, if they're not able to come up and redo deals with Anquan Boldin, Jacoby Jones, some, you know, thoughts have been at least sort of pushed in the direction or suggested that those guys might be some difficult impending decisions for these Ravens as well. There seems to be a consensus on the importance of keeping Danelle Ellerbe moving forward at the important middle linebacker position, one that's going to find itself in transition regardless of how the Ravens choose to address it this offseason, with Ray Lewis riding off into the sunset. And ideally, I think fans would like to have at least Danelle Ellerbe back to hold down a part of the duties now vacated by Ray Lewis, and that would certainly seem to move close to the top of the immediate priority list of these Ravens as well before he is able to go out in free agency and find himself an offer that the Ravens are, for whatever reason, unable to match up with. But once again, 410-481-1570 is the number. You are listening to 1570 AM, WNST Towson, Baltimore, and streaming live on the web at WNST.net. We never stop talking Baltimore sports. This hour brought to you by AAA. AAA wants you to eat out more and taste the good life with big dining discounts at Restaurant.com and Hard Rock Cafe. Learn more about these discounts and others at AAA.com/discounts. Mobtown Sports Beat returns after this. Les Carpenter, Yahoo Sports, scheduled to join us. We never stop talking.
I love you, Baltimore. Baltimore! Forever, my son.